Well, coming up, a tragic car accident turns one man's world upside down.
I don't think I've ever cried for that long and that hard. Just an overwhelming pain of a loss.
Until he found peace in the one person he rejected.
He's so faithful to comfort those who mourn.
Today on 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Well, welcome to the program. There are pivotal moments in life that can change the course of your future. For Ian Thornton, it was a phone call that threw him off track.
Once a happy-go-lucky kid, Ian suddenly became lost and isolated until the day he began to listen to the voice that put a smile back on his face.
I loved life as a child. It was just whimsical. I remember seeing everything completely different. You just live life without the cares of the world, without worries. You get to just have fun. And I feel like I definitely felt that as a child, that childlike faith to believe in things that almost don't make sense to believe in sometimes. When I was 12, I feel like that's just like a real pivotal time in everybody's life. It was a married couple. They were my friends that treated me like I mattered, like I counted. Yeah, I remember I just came home from school and my mom was on the phone weeping, then, you know, telling me, my friend, she just died. She died in a car accident with a baby. I don't think I've ever cried for that long and that hard. Just hours and hours of just like crying out, why? Why would something like this happen? Not really having any answers or any real resolution. Just an overwhelming pain of a loss. Life kind of shift then from that childhood whimsy and that childhood faith even to experiencing like a pain that deep and like really not being able to process it, but experiencing it. The only emotion I could really connect to was anger. Felt safe. It could come on and then you can express it, lash out. Anything to not feel vulnerable. Losing somebody feels so powerless. Almost like your power is stripped from you. Started getting in bands, addicted to cigarettes, doing drugs, drinking, finding anything like that anger to detract from pain and the possibility of feeling pain, but being able to feel something in pursuit of something, in pursuit of a real encounter, a real like experience that wasn't gonna kill me, wasn't gonna hurt me. So it was this self-protection.
I don't care.
I'm not gonna let people get close enough to me for me to be able to feel that. I'm not gonna open up my heart or my guard to be able to even come to the point where I'd be attached to anything enough to cry about it or attached to anything enough to actually feel love. It was just the struggle of the life that I'm in and the life I could have. Me and a bunch of friends that were in just as much crap decided, well, we know God's real. Let's just get together and worship him. Even though we're still doing everything that we're doing, we're still doing drugs, we're still sleeping around, we're still, you know, in all this. We can't deny that he's real. In that place, beginning for the first time to hear his voice, the kindness behind his voice and what his actual heart for me was. Went on 4-hour, 5-hour long walks just throughout my neighborhood, feeling his presence while I walked and just told him everything. He just began to reveal himself to me. Just as like that intensified one after the other, all the addictions started just falling off. They just didn't make sense anymore. He just started showing me his value for me. He told me to leave my comfort zone and really leave the group of friends that I was in, my friends that did want God but were still living the lives that they were living. I have a real difficult time processing heavy emotions. For me, it really had to happen through music. I had to write a song that I'd probably never share with anybody about what I was feeling. What was the deep, deep, indiscernible thoughts going on in my soul.
To give rather than take.
Rather than my music being angry, it's me really embracing the whole realm of emotions and like really being able to process things like love, being able to process things even like loss, being able to actually let go of it rather than holding on to it forever.
Love doesn't grow on trees.
No matter the weight of the situation and the pain you're feeling and the hurt you're going through, just feel it all. Get it all out, because He's so faithful to comfort those who mourn.
And it's worth dying for.
Death seems to be part of life, seems to be a part of even growing up, that we have all had a touch at some point in time, our lives. And in that process, are you looking at where you're going and where you're going to be? And are you ready for that? I'll never forget riding in a jeepney in a remote island of the Philippines, and the driver was trying to somehow save electricity in his own car, and so he'd turn off the lights, and we were driving at night, and there was a bumper sticker where I was sitting right in front of me, said, "Prepare to meet your maker." And so, are you ready? And that certainly increased my prayer life as I'm going through the sugarcane fields and the island in the Philippines. And it may seem humorous now, but at the point in time that I was doing that, it wasn't humorous. And I had to come to grips with, am I ready? Is this something I'm ready to do? Ask yourself, are you ready? If you were to die today, would you know where you're going? Would you have the assurance that your sins are forgiven? Do you have the assurance that now with Jesus there is no more condemnation? Do your own thoughts condemn you? Are you sitting on unconfessed sins? Do you even wonder, is Jesus real? Does he have the answer? Can you spend eternity with him? Can you have the promise of eternal life, and do you have it now? Well, if any of those questions don't line up in your own spirit, well, now's the time to get right. Because the Bible says we're not promised tomorrow. We're not promised it at all. But we are promised today, and we are promised salvation if we just ask for it. So if you're wondering, if you've got any questions, now's the time to get right with God. Now's the time to find peace with him, to understand that he loves you, and he's ready, willing, and able to forgive you, to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And Jesus is able to present you in his presence, spotless, with exceeding joy, if you just receive him. If this is brand new to you, just a very simple prayer. Jesus, if you're there, if this is real, if I really can be forgiven, would you show me? Would you come to me? Would you be with me? The Bible says when you seek him with all of your heart, then you'll find him. And if you've already prayed that prayer, you've already had salvation, you already know the joy of it, but for whatever reason, there's unconfessed sin in your life, now's the day to get right with God. Don't think God's mad at you. If we confess our sin, he will be faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Get right with God. Turn to the source that can cleanse you, that can make you new again, that can give you back that joy and that peace that you long for. If you need help with this, if you want someone to pray with you, if there are things that are burdening your heart, you know, I believe in confession. Confession is the way to find cleansing. If you just want to talk to us, we're here for you. 888-777-1999. Don't let another day go by. Find peace with God and do it today. Call us now. 888-777-1999. Terry?
Well, up next, a man who brings joy in an unlikely place.
God's voice spoke to me some 9.5 years ago to sing to his people as they transition.
Find out how his music is bringing comfort to others at the most important time of their lives.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. All I had was pain and no relief. There was a sizable mass consistent with a malignant cancer in upper right lung. And that's complex, that's tough stuff. I was walking, talking, but I didn't know how sick I was.
I remembered seeing the ad for Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and I thought, this is the place he needs to be.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The game plan was chemotherapy and radiation throughout the whole period. It was an aggressive plan of attack. I liked that.
We gave him chemotherapy and radiation. He was an amazing patient. He tolerated treatment exceptionally well.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity. And the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again.
George does have his life back now. He has a life that I never thought he was gonna have.
With the teamwork, the treatment plans, the facilities, the combination of all the aspects of the treatment, I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Well, the man in our next story is bringing joy to others when they need it most. Kevin Dunn is a father of five who had lost his job and then discovered he had an unlikely calling in hospice.
Then sings my song, my Savior God, to thee.
My name is Kevin Dunn.
Oh, Lord.
God's voice spoke to me some 9.5 years ago to sing to his people as they transition.
I, an awesome wonder.
I knew I wanted to volunteer my gift through song. And one morning I was taking the kids to school, and as I was on my way back home, I was at a traffic light, and God spoke to me, and God said, hospice. But immediately I knew I did not want to do this because I'm a compassionate person. The only thing I thought when it came to hospice was people actually came here to die. And that was it. There was no left, no right, no middle. You know, you just came here to die. Knowing the clarity of the voice I heard, I knew I had to be expedient about looking into this. I made the call the next day. When I first came to hospice, the last two pods, nobody were in the pods. I actually went down there to sing, and I think I found out on my fifth week that those rooms were empty. I took that as God setting the room with his atmosphere through song, so when people did come in, they would feel his presence.
And I know.
Sometimes people open the doors, sometimes they don't. A lot of times, people would come to me and say they never saw me, but they knew I was out there singing.
Sweet.
I'm a firm believer that God's spirit can dwell in the atmosphere.
Sweet heavenly dove.
But God has given me strength to just understand there's a appointed time to live, and there is appointed time to die. I'm coming in here to bless them, and they end up blessing me, telling me to, you know, hold on, even though that they're in pain and they're suffering, you know, still telling me that God is real.
And I know.
My mom passed about 2 years ago. I had a chance to actually sing to mom at her bedside during her transition and had a piece about it. I knew she heard me. The hospice prepared me to just be what I needed to be for my mom during that time. Some people come in and who have not known God, and they've shared with me that with this ministry, they understood that God was real and they wanted to accept Christ. It's increased my faith to know that God is still real, and if you honor Him and you honor His word, He's faithful to honor you as well.
Beautiful. Well, when we come back, we have a story for you. An abandoned baby on a doorstep finds a reason to smile. You'll see why right after this.
There's something that's missing, and I want to tell you that something missing is Jesus.
It was the beginning of a road of redemption for me.
There's forgiveness. There's a new life. There's everything in trusting God. Just take that one step. That's all it takes.
I felt like a new person, brand new creation. I felt like I had had a weight lifted off my shoulders.
Watch The 700 Club next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Well, coming up, discover what your husband isn't telling you.
Honey, there's a woman at work who's been tempting me. She's coming on to me, and I really want to stay faithful to you.
A pastor spills the beans about the things your husband doesn't want you to know. On the next 700 Club Interactive. In the Western world, when the mother has a baby she doesn't want, usually it ends in abortion. But in China, sometimes it ends with them being abandoned at birth. And baby Enyi was one of those who was abandoned. Her parents left her on someone else's doorstep because she was born with a birth defect.
Mr. and Mrs. Feng run Living Hope Christian Orphanage, where they always welcome abandoned children with open arms. Mrs. Feng remembers the day someone dropped a box off at her front door. Inside the box, she found a baby girl with a cleft lip and palate.
The little baby I found at my door was in desperate need of love and immediate surgery.
Mrs. Feng took the baby in and named her Enyi, which means God's grace will make her feel sweet.
Even with her cleft lip and palate, she still liked to smile, but I noticed that whenever she saw strangers, she would cover her mouth with her hand right away, like she knew there was something wrong with her. But the way she looked wasn't the only problem. The cleft lip made it hard to feed her, so she started losing weight.
Mr. and Mrs. Feng knew that cleft lip and palate surgery was Enyi's only hope, but the couple could barely provide basic necessities for the children already in their care. So Mrs. Feng contacted CBN.
In the past years, CBN had helped us with free cleft lip and palate surgeries for some of our other orphans. Those surgeries made all the difference in the children's lives.
We quickly set up surgery for their baby girl.
The news made me so happy, and all the volunteers that help us at the orphanage hugged each other and smiled and jumped for joy when I told them that CBN said yes.
Nyi's cleft lip and palate surgery was a success. Now she loves to play with her friends and she can't stop smiling.
We are so encouraged by CBN's help. Now we don't have to worry anymore.
I want to thank CBN for the timely surgery you have provided for Nyi. Your help completely transformed her face and gave her a chance on life.
Giving someone a chance on life. That's what Jesus came to do. He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And he's authorized us to be his ambassadors to do the same thing. So if you want to be part of it, be part of everything we're doing, you can actually do this just straight from your living room by joining the 700 Club. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing to help people around the world. Another portion goes into CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. So if you want to be a part of everything we're doing, just join the 700 Club. It's real easy. Pick up the phone and call us. Toll free, 888-777-1999. Just say, yes, I want to join the 700 Club. When you join, we've got something for you. I want you to have it. It's called God's Plan for America, my father's latest DVD teaching on what are the plans for America and what does God think about when he thinks about America. You know, and does he think about those early settlers with the dawn of the English settlements here where they started with a prayer meeting on a beach? He does remember that. He remembers the covenant that was made. So if you'd like that, just join the 700 Club. It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. Call right now, 888-777-1999. Well, we've got some emails, an email question. I'll ask the first one. Shannon writes in, I'm new to the interactive chat room, and I recently posted a prayer request. And it wasn't long before another chatter wrote a prayer for me. I prayed it out loud and felt God cleanse my heart. I'm a true witness of God's amazing power. I'd never felt worthy of God's love before now. So thank you so much for your show and your many viewers. I like that one. And the reason I like it is that it underscores something that I think is an absolute principle in prayer. That prayer, when it's out loud, there's a power to that. A power gets released. Yeah. And I've noticed in my own prayers that when I pray them out loud, I'm listening and I can kind of tell, do I really believe what I just said? Yeah. And it gives you a check. And then you can come back at it again and say, no, let's really move it. And
prayer, I think, becomes really specific when you pray out loud, too. You know, when you're just praying quietly in your head, things wander. Right. But when you're speaking it, I think there is power in the spoken word. It affirms who we are.
And I also think there's power in community prayer. Mm-hmm. The reason the Lord's Prayer begins with our, he's intentional that we need to pray in community and reaffirm one another in prayer. Mm-hmm. So someone writes a prayer in a chat room, you repeat it out loud to yourself, it can really move things.
Okay, well, here's one for you. This is from Doug, who writes, hi, Terry and Gordon. I'm confused by scriptures that speak of judgment. I have trouble reconciling the talk of there being, quote, no condemnation in Christ. However, we are still to face judgment when we die. Can you bring light to this for me?
Well, Hebrews talks about as appointed a man wants to die and then the judgment. Paul spoke that we all have to stand. And now the issue is who's standing with you? If you're up there on your own, well, then you pretty much have to defend yourself. And you probably already know that you're not defensible, that you're guilty as charged. What happens is that at the judgment, you have your advocate, and his name is Jesus. And he's going to tell the judge that I've covered this. This transgression is paid for, and it's paid for in my blood. That's why the Bible says he is able to present you spotless in his presence with exceeding joy. And not just the forgiveness of sin, but the remission where it's completely taken away and you're justified. I love the messianic titles that Jesus is a friend of sinners. That's really good because that means he's my friend. That he justifies the ungodly. That's really good because he justifies me. And so put your hope there in him on what he's already done. And then you can get through all the verses on judgment to say, Jesus has got that covered for me. Sonia writes in, should Christians get involved in politics? What do you think about that one?
Well, I think they should. I mean, I think, you know, the alternative to that is people who don't share godly principles or values are going to be in positions of authority and of decision-making, of law-making, law-breaking. Mm-hmm. And so I think that it's key.
Yeah,
for
establishing, mm-hmm. I'm hearing a phrase, the new morality. Mm-hmm. I think it's incumbent on every citizen to participate in the political process, specifically by voting. I also hold to something that perhaps we've gotten away from, that there are specific callings for people. You know, some people are called into leadership, political leadership, into political power. We seem to have dismissed that in these days, but I think for some Christians, there is a calling to work in government, to work in public service, and if you have that, then you need to listen to that call.
Well, and creative ideas and solutions to things come from the Lord. I mean, I think of Joseph in the Old Testament, mm-hmm. and how God not only put him in a position of authority in the land, but gave him the creative idea of how to build storehouses and how to, you know, save and then meet out what people needed during a time of great famine, and saved not only his family, but the entire country he was living in. So, I mean, I think when we understand that those ideas of creativity come from God, why wouldn't you want somebody like that in a position of decision-making in the country?
We could use some Josephs today.
Well, we sure could.
We could use a Daniel.
Yeah.
We could use a David. We could use a Solomon. Mm-hmm. We could even use a Cyrus, all of whom were the Bible's very specific. They were called by God to that particular position, that he wanted them to be in a position of ruling. Of leadership, of stewardship, and they all took that very seriously. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I think also it's such a great opportunity. You know, we both travel and do work in other countries, and sometimes the head person, as in Joseph's time, isn't the believer, but someone under him serving, mm-hmm. and bringing wisdom to the table and living a life of godly values has tremendous impact on people who are in those top leadership position. So there are all kinds of ways that God uses us as believers in the whole governmental system. But I do think it's really important for
and
us.
I'll add one other, I guess, warning.
Yeah.
Politics is not going to get the job done. And if you put all of your energy into political solutions, you're missing the much bigger picture. Until the hearts of the people change, until they turn to God, So much of our democracy is built on the individual taking responsibility for their own actions and living under the law of liberty, which is, number one, you love God, and number two, you love one another. And we've gotten so far away from that as a culture, where literally we exploit one another, that we have greed has taken over, pride has taken over. You know, you start listing the seven deadly sins, and boy, Americans are guilty of a whole bunch of them. So we've got to have a return on an individual community basis to understanding we're one nation under God. Well, let's go over to our chat room. Marguerite's got some.
Yes, Kelsey says, how can we pray for others to find joy if they have almost no self-worth?
If they have no self-worth? Okay. Well, pray for that first. So much of joy is understanding who you are in Christ. You know, joy from a worldly standpoint is based on pleasure. And pleasure is so fleeting. But when you understand that you really are a child of God, that he really does love you, that he really wants you with him for all eternity, that he died for you, that the worth he attributes to you is that he's willing to sacrifice Jesus for you. When you really get that, then all the self-condemnation goes away. All the feeling that you're unworthy goes away. And with that comes joy. And that's what God wants to bring. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So work on that first. That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Lamentations. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each day. I said to myself, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore, I will hope in him. God bless you. We'll see you again.